الآخرة أإذا كنا عظاما نخرة قالوا تلك إذا كرة خاسرة فإنما هي زجرة واحدة فإذا هم بالساهرة هل أتاك حديث موسى إذ ناداه ربه بالوادي المقدس طوى اذهب إلى فرعون إنه طغى اذهب إلى فرعون إنه طغى فقل هل لك إلى أن تزكى وأهديك إلى ربك فتخشى فأراه الآية الكبرى فكذب وعصى ثم أدبر يسعى فحشر فنادى فقال أنا ربكم الأعلى فأخذه الله نكال الآخرة والأولى إن في ذلك لعبرة لمن يخشى أأنتم أشد خلقا أم السماء بناها رفع سمكها فسواها وأغطش ليلها وأخرج ضحاها والأرض بعد ذلك دحاها أخرج منها ماءها ومرعاها والجبال أرساها متاعا لكم ولأنعامكم فإذا جاءت الطامة الكبرى يوم يتذكر الإنسان ما سعى وبرزت الجحيم لمن يرى فأما من طغى وآثر الحياة الدنيا فإن الجحيم هي المأوى وأما من خاف مقام ربه ونهى النفس عن الهوى فإن الجنة هي المأوى يسألونك عن الساعة أيان مرساها فيما أنت من ذكراها إلى ربك منتهاها إنما أنت منذر من يخشاها كأنهم يوم يرونها لم يلبثوا إلا عشية وضحاها صدق الله العلي العظيم ورسوله الكريم اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد Thank you brother Adnan Now this time we'd like to get the majlis started. I'd like to request those that are in the middle hall to kindly make their way in so we can start the program. I'd like to request Brother Hassan to come up and read the Hadith Kissa. Salat bar Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. In the name of Allah, the All-Merciful, the All-Compassionate. Fatima al-Zahra, the daughter of the Prophet, peace be on them, is to have thus related an event. My father, the Prophet of Allah, came to my house one day and said to me, Peace be on you, Fatima. I replied, And upon you be peace. Then he said, I feel weakness in my body. I said, Allah protects you from weaknesses, Father. He said, Fatima, please bring the Yemeni cloak and cover me with it. So I brought the Yemeni cloak and covered him with it. Then I looked at him and saw that his face was shining like a full moon with its glory and splendor. After a while, my son came in and said, "Peace be on you, mother." I replied, "And upon you, peace, O light of my eyes and the delight of my heart." He then said, "Mother, I smell a fragrance so sweet and so pure as that of my grandfather, the Prophet of Allah." I replied, "Yes, your grandfather is lying underneath the cloak." Hassan went near the cloak and said, "Peace be on you, my grandfather, the Prophet of Allah. May I enter the cloak with you?" He replied, "And upon you, peace, my son and the master of my fountain, Gothar. You are given the permission to enter." So Hassan entered the cloak with him. After a while, my son Hussein came in and said, "Peace be on you, mother." I replied, "And upon you, peace, O light of my eyes and the delight of my heart." He then said, "Mother, I smell a sweet fragrance like that of my grandfather, the Prophet of Allah." I replied, "Yes, your grandfather and your brother are lying underneath the cloak." Hussein stepped towards the cloak and said, "Peace be on you, my grandfather, the children of Allah. May I enter the cloak with you?" He replied, "And upon you, peace, my son and the interceder of my followers. You are given the permission to enter." So Hussein entered the cloak with them.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
After a while, Abul Hasan Ali bin Abi Talib came in and said, "Peace be on you, O daughter of the Prophet of Allah." I replied, "And upon you, peace, O father of Hasan and the commander of the faithful." He then said, "Fatima, I smell a sweet fragrance like that of my brother, my cousin, the Prophet of Allah." I replied, "Yes, he is underneath the cloak with your two sons." So Ali went near the cloak and said, "Peace be on you, Prophet of Allah. May I enter the cloak with you?" He replied, "And upon you, peace, my brother, my legatee, my successor, and my standard bearer. You are given the permission to enter." So Ali entered the cloak with them. Then I stepped forward and said, "Peace be on you, my father, O Prophet of Allah. May I enter the cloak with you?" He replied, "And upon you, peace, my daughter, O part of myself. You are given the permission to enter." So I entered the cloak with them. Getting together underneath the cloak, my father, the Prophet of Allah, held the two ends of the cloak and raised his right hand towards the heavens and prayed, "O Allah, these are the people of my household, Ahlul Bayt. They are my confidants and my supporters. Their flesh is my flesh, and their blood is my blood. Whoever hurts them hurts me too. Whoever displeases them displeased me too. I am at war with those at war with them. I am at peace with those at peace with them. I am the enemy of their enemies, and I am the friend of their friends. They are from me, and I am from them. O Allah, bestow your blessings, benevolence, forgiveness, and your pleasure upon me and upon them, and remove impurity from them, and keep them thoroughly pure." Then the Lord Almighty Allah said, "O my angels, O residents of my heavens, verily I have not created the erected sky, the stretched earth, the illuminated moon, the bright sun, the rotating planets, the flowing seas, and the sailing ships, but for the love of these five lying underneath the cloak." Jibrail, the trusted angel, asked, "Who are under the cloak?" The Almighty answered, "They are the household of the Prophet and the assets of prophethood. They are Fatima, her father, her husband, and her two sons." Jibrail said, "O Lord, may I fly to earth to be the sixth of them?" Allah replied, "Yes, you are given the permission." Jibrail, the trusted, landed near them and said, "Peace be on you, O Prophet of Allah. The All-Highest conveys his peace on you and his greetings and says, by my honor and glory, O my angels, O residents of my heavens, verily I have not created the erected sky, the stretched earth, the illuminated moon, the bright sun, the rotating planets, the flowing seas, and the sailing ships, but for your sake and love. God has given me permission to enter the cloak with you. May I join you, O Prophet of Allah? The Prophet replied, and peace be on you, O trusted bearer of Allah's revelations. You are granted the permission. So Jibreel entered the cloak with us and said to my father, Allah sends his revelations to you. Verily, Allah's desire is to keep away blemish from you, O people of household Ahlul Bayt, and purify you with the perfect purification. Then Ali said to my father, O Prophet of Allah, tell me, what significance has Allah given for getting together underneath this cloak? The Prophet replied, by him who rightfully appointed me a prophet and chose me a messenger for the salvation of the mankind. Whenever and wherever an assembly of our followers and friends mention this event, Allah will bestow on them his blessings and mercy. Angels will encircle them, asking Allah the remission of their sins until the assembly disperse. So Ali said, verily, by the Lord of Kaaba, we and our followers are the winners. Then my father replied, by him who rightfully appointed me a prophet and chose me a messenger for the salvation of the mankind. Whenever and wherever an assembly of our followers and friends mention this event, there shall remain none grieved, but Allah will remove his grief. There shall remain none distressed, but Allah will dispel his distress. There shall remain none wish seeker, but Allah will grant his wish. Ali happily said, verily by the Lord of Kaaba, we and our followers are the winners and the blessed in this world and the next.
Salawat. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Thank you, Hassan. That wonderful rendition of this kissa. Salawat par Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Waiting for Maulana to arrive, I just like to request Brother Nihal to read a poem for us, inshallah.
صلی علی محمد و آل محمد صلی علی محمد و آل محمد Oh, come, let us learn how to live like Ali, to live like Ali and to die like Hussein. To live as a servant of Allah alone, to struggle for justice until you are slain. The gate of the city of knowledge, Ali, he learned from Muhammad and showed how to be. He learned from Muhammad and showed how to be. He died protecting that knowledge, Hussein, so teachings of prophets would not go in vain. Oh, come, let us learn how to live like Ali, to live like Ali and to die like Hussein. When no one would answer the call of Nabi, the people would witness the sword of Ali. The people would witness the sword of Ali. And now like a mountain before tyranny, standing alone is the fearless Hussein. Oh, come, let us learn how to live like Ali, to live like Ali and to die like Hussein. He gave his zakat in ruku of salah, for such is the bounty of Mushkil Kusha. For such is the bounty of Mushkil Kusha. And quenching the thirst of the army of Hor, are the sons of Ali and the sons of Hussein. Oh, come, let us learn how to live like Ali, to live like Ali and to die like Hussein. Salawat.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Thank you, Brother Nihal. A couple of quick announcements before we get going. Inshallah, the overflow again is in the basement for the sisters who have the young kids. You can go and take advantage of that extra room in the basement. Inshallah, if you'd like to make any contribution towards the Niaz, you can see me, or there's a table out there in the hall making contributions there. Want to just give you guys a schedule for tomorrow, so you have it handy, Ram. So tomorrow, Ashura, inshallah, we'll have a majlis, Urdu majlis, at around 4:16 a.m. And then at 8:30 a.m. will be a ladies' majlis. 10 a.m. will be the amal. Around 11:15 we'll have the soul salam for the English majlis. Inshallah, Maulana will take the member by 12 p.m. Inshallah. And then we'll wrap up the English majlis, and inshallah, I'll have Salat al-Zohr and at around 1:14. Inshallah, 1:45 will be the Urdu majlis, and then followed that up with the Jalus and the Matam at 3 p.m. And Faka Shikni. Inshallah, 5:30 will be the graveyard majlis, inshallah, on Route 1. And back here at Dar Jafia around 8:50 for Salat al-Maghribain, and 9:10 will be the Shami Gariba Majlis, inshallah. So we have a full packed day, inshallah, tomorrow. Please try to attend as many events as possible. Now, without further ado, before Mullah Kalamala, please kindly move forward as much as you can. We're expecting a full packed house tonight. It's the night before Ashura. Mona, please. Salawat for Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
رحم الله من قرأ سورة المبارك الفاتحة أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من اللعين الغوي الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وبه نستعين والحمد لله رب العالمين والعاقبة للمتقين والصلاة والسلام على خيرة خلق الله أجمعين وهو أفضل هو أفضل الأنبياء والمرسلين هو ابن قاسم المصطفى محمد والصلاة والسلام على أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المظلومين الميامين المهديين المقتولين ولعنة الله دائمة على عدائهم أجمعين من يومنا هذا إلى قيام يوم الدين ما بعد فقال الله تعالى في كتابه الحكيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وعادا وثمودا وقد تبين لكم من مناسكهم وزين لهم شيطان أعمالهم فصدهم عن سبيلي وكانوا مستبصرين أمنا بالله صدق الله العلي العظيم Tonight is the night of the 10th of Muharram, the night of Ashura. And I want to continue last night's discussion about why do the enemies of Allah, or how do the enemies of Allah become the enemies of Allah. And I began with the ayah that I began with last night from Anqabut 38, which says, and we destroy the Ad and Thamud. Meaning it's become clear to you the story of Ad and Thamud by means of their destruction. You see, you know, their palaces destroyed. And Satan made beautiful for them their actions. So it was a false beauty. So tonight we're going to look at two conceptions of beauty. We're going to look at the beauty of Hussein through the eyes of Hussein and beauty through the eyes of Umar ibn Sa'd. And that's the nature of this world, of the, what we call the beast of this world. Umar ibn Sa'd saw one thing, and Hussein ibn Ali, the imam of the jinn and humans, saw something else. But both of them saw something, and that vision of theirs led them to their respective final position and finalities. I want to begin with a very brief anecdote from Tolstoy's Confessions. I just found this very, very interesting, where he describes the nature of this world. He says, think of the nature of this world as you are a traveler, and a beast is coming towards you. So you're running away, there's a beast. Let's say a vicious dog is running after you. It's going to bite you, running after you. And to save yourself, you jump into a well. You come down the stairs, the ladder of a well, you're now in the well. But when you look to the bottom of the well, you see the mouth of a dragon open. So the bottom of the well has a mouth of a dragon open. Top of the well has a beast coming after you. You're in trouble. So quickly you find a bush hanging there and you hang on to it. What am I going to do? If I go down, I'm destroyed. If I come back up, I'm destroyed. So you hang on to this vine, to this bush, you know, like. But then you notice you're hanging onto that bush and there's a black mouse and a white mouse that are chewing at it. So that's going to break too. So you're hanging from a bush, from the vine, right? But there's two mice nibbling away at it. You're hanging on for dear life. Dragon's mouth at the bottom. Some kind of beast at the top. You're hanging on to this tree of some sort, this vine from a tree. It's being eaten at by two mice. Then all of a sudden you stop. And you see a couple of drops of honey on the leaves. And in that moment, you reach out to lick that honey. Our days and nights and the pleasures of our life are no more than those few drops of honey. The moment you reach out with your tongue to lick it, you're gone. That is the nature of the dunya. That's the nature of this world. And that's why Abu Abdullah, when he arrived in Karbala, he wrote a letter to Muhammad bin Hanafiya. It's narrated in Kamil al-Ziyarat. It's a one-sentence letter. Can you imagine? One sentence Abu Abdullah wrote. He says, this is a letter from Hussein ibn Ali to Muhammad and to the other Hashemites that are with him. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. كَأَنَّ الدُّنْيَا لَمْ يَكُنْ وَكَأَنَّ الْآخِرَةَ
لم تزل والسلام الحسين بن علي. He says, it is as if this world never existed, and it is as if the next world never ends. The moment we reach our tongue out to lick that honey, we could have held on to the leaf, to that rope. But they just wanted a taste of the honey. Just give me a taste of the honey. Just a taste. And that's the nature of this world. Those few drops of honey, khalas, masadam, gone, done. Abba Abdullah sums up the whole story of insan in that those 3-4 words in a letter that he wrote to Muhammad ibn Hanafiyah from Karbala. On one hand, you have this nothing but beautiful vision of Hussein ibn Ali. I don't think anything could describe it as the most succinct description of existence. The most beautiful, comprehensive understanding of what things are. On the other hand, Imam Zain al-Abidin tells us that there was no day like the day of Hussein ibn Ali. On that day, 30,000 men claiming to be from this Muslim ummah gathered against them, each of them seeking to get close to Allah by spilling the blood of that man Hussein. How? The man who wrote that letter, 30,000 men, Imam Zain al-Abidin says in hadith, 30,000 men are lined up to kill him. Qurbatan ilallah. How? Yet he says, my father Hussein continued. He says, wallahi, I swear that my father Hussein continued to advise them with mu'idha until they killed him. Baghyan wa dhulman wa udwana, out of rebellion, oppression, and total blind hatred. So how did Umar ibn Sa'd, the son of a Sahabi of Rasulullah who we spoke about yesterday, allow this to happen in Karbala on the 10th of Muharram? How? Because at the end of the day, he was the commander of the Yazidi forces there. I'm not saying Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad is not responsible for Yazid. Yes, but at the end of the day, Umar ibn Sa'd is the one who was there giving the commands to the soldiers. In order to understand this, we have to look at two things tonight. Number one, to understand the fickleness, hypocrisy, and games of Umar ibn Sa'd, we have to go back to Kufa. Right? A killer doesn't become a killer overnight. Takes something to make a killer. Okay? Serial killers don't become serial killers, and sociopaths don't just become sociopaths just like that. There's certain things they do in their life that make them narcissists and sociopaths. Muslim ibn Aqil is brought to the castle of Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad. I don't know how many mu'mineen know the history of this history. Now, Muslim is about to be sentenced to death by Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad in Kufa. But Muslim had three things that he wanted to leave as a will. His wasiyah consisted of three things. He looks around. Ibn Fattal, Nishapuri, and other people, Dhahabi, other people narrate this in the histories. He looks around and he says, there's only one person that I have a qaraba and relation with here. Guess who it is? Umar ibn Sa'd. Because they had a family connection. I mentioned that last night. They had a silat al-rahim, a connection of blood. So he says, Umar ibn Sa'd, I ask you to witness three things, and you keep it between us. This is before Umar ibn Sa'd becomes the commander of the Yazidi forces and everything. This is still in the time, in Kufa. So Muslim approaches Umar ibn Sa'd. This is just before the Shahadat of Muslim ibn Aqil. Just before. He says, I will three things to you. Number one, that my body, you take care of my body after I die. Take it from the possession of Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad and make sure I have a proper burial. This is the least you could do. We have blood ties. Now remember, for the Arabs, this is a big deal. If you're from my tribe or you're tied to me by blood, that's a sacred bond. Remember, we have to understand the Arab culture, the tribal culture, the Arabic culture. So even though it's Umar ibn Sa'd, he says, look, at the end of the day, bro, we're blood. This is the least I'm going to ask you for. We may be on other sides of things, but at least do this for much for me. Number two, I have a loan. I need you to deal with it. Because Muslim did not want to die with a loan on his neck. He had to pay off his debts. Number three, I ask you to at least tell Hussein not to come to Kufa. The situation has not arisen, obviously. I'm in the situation that I'm in now. There's no point of Hussein ibn Ali coming to Kufa. So send news to him not to come to Kufa. Umar ibn Sa'd promised to Muslim through the bond of God and blood. The bond of God and blood. Double bond. Okay. Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad was standing outside the room because he promised that he would not get involved. This is according to the history of Islam, as it's written in many historical sources, Sunni and Shia sources. As I said, Nafattal, Dahabi, others. He comes out of the room, Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad asks him, what's up? Boom, all three he gave it to him. La'anatullahi. Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad says, as for the body and the loan, I could care less. Let him, although at the end of the day, they end up crucifying him and throwing him in a garbage dump, so they didn't even fulfill that much when it came to Muslims' wishes. He says, as for telling Hussein, no, I won't allow that to happen. Muslim, of course, did not know. By this time, Muslim was executed. He didn't know that this guy broke the bond with God and the bond of blood. Double nifaq, double. This is Umar ibn Sa'd. He was a man who went where the buck was. He knew, this is not gonna get me anywhere. This guy is gonna get me a job, he's gonna get me this, he's gonna get me that. So he sold out Muslim ibn Aqil. But the saddest part of the story was Umar ibn Sa'd had a connection to Quraysh. He had a connection to Banu Hashim. He knew who they were. He knew their history. He knew everything about them. Not like Shimr. Shimr was not Umar ibn Sa'd. Those are two different characters. Ibn Ziyad was not Umar. Ibn Ziyad was a total psychopath. Straight up. Sickle. Umar ibn Sa'd was a guy who just played every team. He would wait till the last minute to see which team to play for. This was Umar ibn Sa'd. Umar ibn Sa'd arrives now because he was sent by Ibn Ziyad to confront Hussein. لما نزل عمر ابن سعد بالحسين أيكنا أنهم قاتلوه. That when he arrived, he had certainty that they were going to fight Hussein. Now, why does this matter, my dear brothers? His ticket to hell was sealed. Do you know what he did? This is so disturbing. He gathered the troops and he gave a khutbah in Karbala, Umar ibn Sa'd. He says, do you not see how the dunya is changing its colors? But know that the cause of Allah is in fighting Hussein today. This is the same guy that said, oh yeah, yeah, Muslim, we're friends. We know each other, we go way back, I'm with Hussein. Now he's in Karbala and saying the cause of God is in fighting Hussein. He says, "Ala tarawna al-haq la ya'malu bi." O army, do you not see that the truth is not being acted upon? والباطل لا يتناهى عنه. And invalid and wrong and batil is not being prevented. Meaning Hussein is not doing nahi and al munkar. I, Umar ibn Sa'd, today are here because haq needs to be done. وَلِيَرْغَبَ الْمُؤْمِنُ فِي لِقَاءِ اللَّهِ. Whoever wants to meet God, know that you are with me today. This is the opening address of Umar ibn Sa'd to his troops in Karbala. Does that register? This is beauty through the eyes of Umar ibn Sa'd. The meeting of God, al-amr bil ma'roof, and nahi anil munkar, and guess what? He believed none of it. He all knew it was a fraud. Umar ibn Sa'd knew this was a fraud. As I said, they were childhood friends. He knew who Hussein was. There was no doubt about this. He is not Shimr and he is not Ibn Ziyad. Umar ibn Sa'd knew exactly what he was getting into. But power is power, and when one has a will to power, they will do anything. They will become a gangster, they will become a killer, they will become a dealer, whatever. Gangsterism, like the gangsterism of Umar ibn Sa'd, knows no end. That's all it is, gangsterism. In the name of Allah. In the name of Akhirat. In the name of Haqq. In the name of fighting batil. And the prophets and the imams were not naive to this. In fact, Umar ibn Sa'd and Imam Hussein had 3 to 4 meetings before Ashura. I don't know how many people know that. There were 3 to 4 sit-downs to try to find an arbitration or a resolution to this issue. Imam knew he was dealing with a slippery customer. He knew this. But Imam said, at the end of the day, you have to go through the process. 3 to 4 meetings, I will only narrate 2 of them to you now. Meeting number 1, Hussein ibn Ali offers 3 conditions to him. He says, number 1, I will leave from where I have come from. So leave me alone, me and my family. Let me go. Just let me go. I won't go to Kufa. There won't be an uprising. Let me go. Number 2, the historians have reported this. Number 2, I will go to Yazid myself in Sham. And let me handle the situation with Yazid directly. Of course, he's not going to pledge allegiance, but at least let me go to Damascus and meet Yazid 1-to-1. But on my own will. See what plays out in Damascus. Imam did not have a suicide mind. I don't know where this idea, he made so many efforts to bring this to a close. Number 3, he says, okay, if these 2 you don't accept, I'll give you a 3rd option. 3rd option is you let me go to the furthest city. Somewhere at the borders of the Muslim empire, you let me and my family go. But I will not give, well, what you're asking me, I can't give you, which is obviously bay'ah. That's not going to happen. That's a non-starter because he's Imam of Rabbul Alameen. The Imam cannot give bay'ah, of course. That's not going to happen, allegiance to Yazid. Umar ibn Sa'd actually accepted these 3 conditions. Did you know that? فَقَبَلَ ذَلِكَ Umar, the history says. Umar ibn Sa'd did not want to fight, per se. Even if there's a chance he might get hurt, he didn't want to fight. Again, the guy was with his maslahat. Whatever is the easiest route, I'll take it. Man, he's a businessman, as I said. He wasn't a psychopath. He was just a very crookster. hypocritical, dirty businessman. That's what he was. So he accepts it, or at least pretends to accept it, quote unquote. And all of a sudden, he then writes back to Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad, basically saying, look, these are the terms. Can we just finish this? Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad writes back to him and says, no. There will be no karama, no honor for me until Hussein's hand is in my hand with allegiance. Meaning, bring him to me in Kufa, dead or alive. Alive if he's going to be submitting to me. If not, dead. Hussein, of course, could not accept that. However, the dirty, dirty business. Umar ibn Sa'd did not tell Hussein that he then wrote back to Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad telling Ayyuhal Amir, iktab li, or uktub li, ahad ray. Give me the province of Ray and I'll do what you want. He's, what does he say? Hatta af'alu ma ta'maru fi al-hal. But he didn't tell Hussein this, that he's making backdoor deals. He just pretended like, all right, we're going to meet here, we're going to meet here, we're going to meet here. And in fact, Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad got news that these meetings are happening without his permission. He writes another letter to Umar ibn Sa'd on the battlefield. Because clearly he's saying, Umar ibn Sa'd is delaying this. Why isn't this done? We want this done. Why isn't this story finished yet? Ubaydullah ibn Ziyad now writes another letter to Umar ibn Sa'd, telling him what? News has come to us that you and Hussein are having private conversations. It has come to us that you and Hussein are having private conversations. فَقَدْ بَلَكَنِي عَنَّ حُسَيْنَ وَعُمَرْ يَجْلِسَانِ. It has come to me that these two are having private conversations, and he basically tells him, if warning him, if you do what I think you're going to do, which is let him go, it's on you. If you kill him, the reward is yours. Ibn Ziyad knew how to play Umar ibn Sa'd. He knew Umar ibn Sa'd was a chicken. 100%. He knew that this guy didn't want to carry this out. Banu Hashim is Banu Hashim. It's no joke, Hussein ibn Ali. Umar ibn Sa'd knew this. It's clear in history that he had every opportunity to bring this to an end without bloodshed. He couldn't do it. So what was the final meeting now that ended the whole situation? I will read it to you tonight. Just so people don't think I'm interpolating or exaggerating the history. This is from Tabari's Tariq. A final meeting was arranged between the two parties. Umar ibn Sa'd would bring 20 horsemen, Hussein would bring 20 horsemen, and they would meet. This is Tabari narrates, and Ayatollah Sayyid Muhammad Taqi Bahrul Ulum narrates this in his Maqtal. So they meet on the battlefield. Hussein turns to Umar ibn Sa'd and he tells him, Ibn Sa'd, are you going to fight me? Are you going to kill me? And you know who I know, who I am? Wa ana ibnu man alimt. You know who son I am. You know who I am. I'm confirming face to face with you now, Ya Umar ibn Sa'd, that you know who I am. Hussein is looking into the eyes of Umar ibn Sa'd. Umar is looking into the eyes of Hussein. Qala lahu ibn Sa'd. Yeah, no, then he says, Ala takunu ma'i wa tad'a hawla. He says, be with me, leave these people. Why did Hussein do this? Because Hussein had a childhood history with him. As I mentioned yesterday, these guys go way back. The Imam Salamullahi Alayhi and Umar ibn Sa'd, Abdullah ibn Umar, these guys grew up together. He's looking at someone like you two next to each other, all these years you've been together in the Idara. He could speak this way to him. He was calling into his heart. He's saying, Umar ibn Sa'd, I will take you to God. Join me. Look at what he says to him. قَالَ عُمَرْ أَخَافَ أَنْ تُحْدَمْ ضَارِي. But I fear that my house will be destroyed. Meaning my home. Hussein says that I'll build you one. Meaning in dunya and akhirat I'll build you one. You want a house in this world, I'll build you one in this world. You want an akhirat, I'll give you both. Look at the mercy and the love of Hussein ibn Ali. قَالَ الْحُسَيْنِ. Then he said, قَالَ الْأُمَرِ. Then Hussein turns to Umar ibn Sa'd. He says to him, or rather Umar ibn Sa'd says, I fear that I'm going to lose my wealth. Hussein ibn Ali tells him, I will give you the wealth, my wealth from Hijaz. Yeah, he says, أَنَا أَخْلِفُ عَلَيْكَ خَيْرًا مِنْهَا مِنْ مَالِ بِالْحِجَازِ. I'm not exaggerating. This is the history of Islam. This is the Imam. He says, I will give you my money from Hijaz. If that's the issue, I will give you from Hijaz. No one had the wealth like Hussein ibn Ali in Saudi Arabia, in what is modern day Saudi Arabia or the Arabian Peninsula. Then he says, I have family in Kufa, I'm worried about them. Inna li ayalan bil Kufa wa khafu alayhim. I have family back in Kufa, I'm worried about them. Hussein says, I guarantee their salamat. I guarantee your family's safety. Fasakata Umar ibn Sa'd. Umar ibn Sa'd remained silent. He had no jawab to Hussein ibn Ali. Falam yajibhu bishay. And he did not give any word to him. He remained looking at him. Hussein looked at him. It was silence. At that point, they knew that the story was over. That was the point where now Hussein knew. Of course, he knew already, but in the realm of real world time, Hussein knew that this was the end of the story. There was nothing more to be done. And he says, may God slaughter you in your bed, O Umar ibn Sa'd. Because I have given you this world and akhirat, and you have to turn it down. He says, I swear you will never eat barley in Iraq. Meaning you will never enjoy your life in Iraq. These people will throw you to the dogs as well. He's saying, I know you, man. I know you. We have a history. Umar ibn Sa'd refused. And that was the end of his story. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Mu'mineen, can you please come forward? Please, Mu'mineen. Sallu ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. And from that point forward, all we have is pure rage. Unadulterated, complete, ugly violence. Hussein ibn Ali did every single thing that he could to bring this to a peaceful conclusion. Let no one leave here tonight thinking otherwise. This is Islam. Muslims do not crave blood and violence and fighting. Especially when they're with their babies and their children. Yet I don't know why, but tonight I turn to Sahib al-Zaman and I think of our Shia in Afghanistan. I was reading an article from 2021. I don't know why I bring it now. That there was a blast in 2021. This is what I mean by sheer barbaric violence. Killing 90 Shia girls at the Sayyid al-Shuhada school in Kabul. 90 Shia girls murdered in cold blood, 240 injured, most of them under the age of 18. All of that done because somebody thought they're going to go to heaven for doing it. How do we deal with such evil in this world? Imam al-Hussein taught us something on the day of Ashura, which I'll impart to you tonight. And that is, he knew that he would forever be in the care of the Infinite One, that is God. Everyone may leave him in this world, but he says, Ana abki ilayka makruban. Oh Allah, I am crying to you now on the day of Ashura. Can you imagine? Hussein ibn Ali says, Ana abki ilayka makruban. I come to you with tawbah. Everyone has left me. But I know I have you. This is the jamal and the beauty in the kalam of Hussein. How could his sister not say, وَمَا رَأَيْتُ إِلَّا جَمِيلًا? If how could his sister not say that all I saw was beauty? Why didn't she tell Yazid that all I saw was beauty? Hussein ibn Ali is crying to Allah. Because he knows at the end of the day, the only person that is in his, that he is in his complete embrace, is the hand of God, Yadullah. Right, as the Quran says, Yadullah fawqa aydihim. The hand of God is on top of their hands. This is the jamal and the beauty of Hussein ibn Ali. On the 9th of Muharram, Ibn Sa'ad gets his troops ready. And they began marching towards the tent of Hussein. Zainab heard the screams coming from the army. She turns to Hussein ibn Ali, telling him, what are we going to do now? Now that these screams have coming. Again, this is the moments that show that, of course, Hussein ibn Ali is Imam Ma'asum. The riwayah says that as Zainab came to Hussein, Hussein had his head down. He had his head down. Can you imagine this? Hussein's head is down like this. وَرَعْفَعَ رَأْسُهُ And he all of a sudden lifts his head up. But what did he say to her? رَفَعَ الْحُسَيْنِ رَأْسَ Hussein lifts his head up. And he says, Now إِنِّي رَأَيْتُ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ That now I just saw, oh Zainab, I just saw the Messenger of Allah. And do you know what the Messenger of Allah told me? I had tears in my eyes today when I read this riwayat. He says, فَقَالَ لِي إِنَّكَ تَرُوحْ إِلَيْنَا Oh Hussein, you are coming to us. This was enough for Hussein. The love of Allah and the beauty of Allah was put into the heart through the face of the Messenger of Allah. All Hussein wanted to see was the face of his grandfather, Rasulullah. He says, I saw him and he said, I'm coming to him now. Zainab begins to cry and she begins to hit her cheeks. And as the army got closer, Hussein now meets with Abbas, saying, Abbas, go to the army and tell them to give us one more night in delay. One more night. But do you know what Hussein says? He says, oh Abbas, go to them and ask for one more day of respite. He says, لَعَلَّنَا نُسَلِّي لِرَبِّنَا اللَّيْلَى Perhaps we can pray to God tonight. This is why we're Shia. All this matam, azadari, buka, and tears, Hussein says, so we can pray to God tonight. وَنَدْعُوهُ وَنَسْتَغْفِرُ. So we could seek Allah's forgiveness tonight. Who is Hussein ibn Ali that he's asking for one more night so that we can do istighfar? فَهُوَ يَعْلَمُ أَنِّي كُنْتُ أُحِبَّ الصَّلَاةِ. For my Lord knows that I love namaz. I love salat. وَتِلَاوَةُ كِتَابِهِ. And I love to recite his book. And I love his dua, وَكَثْرَةُ الدُّعَى وَالْإِسْتِغْفَارِ. Hussein is telling Abbas this. Abbas, give me one more night so I could do istighfar. One more night so I could do dua. One more night so I could pray in peace to my Lord. Hada Hussein ibn Ali. And we read in the ziyarat known as ziyarat Nahiya, أُقِيمَتْ لَكَ الْمَآتَمُ فِي أَعْلَى الْإِلِّيِّينَ. And for you in the highest heavens, O Hussein, the matam occurs. A man asking for one more night so he could pray to God. This is the jamal and the beauty through the eyes of Hussein. وَلَتَمَتْ عَلَيْكَ الْهُورِ الْعِينَ. And even the Hur al-Ain do latmiya, they do matam for you, O Hussein. Why? Why does the Hur al-Ain do matam for Hussein? Yeah. Imam Rida alayhi salam tells us, فَإِنَّ يَوْمِ الْحُسَيْنِ, that on the day of Hussein, أَذَلَّ عَزِيزًا. Adalla Azizuna. That our Aziz Hussein was made humiliated and dhaleel. Assalamu alayka al madhloom bila nasir. Peace be upon all the one who is oppressed with no helper.
Ya Hussein!
O Hussein, your liwa was gone. Your riot and your flag was gone. Right? The riwayah says Hussein looked right and he looked left. وَلَمْ يَرَ أَحَدَ. And he saw nobody. All he could hear was the screams of the women and the children. So what does Hussein do now that the history tells us? He begins to yell, هَلْ مِنْ ذَابٍ عَنْ حُرَّمِ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ. Is there anyone that will help the family of the Prophet, the sanctuary of the Prophet? هَلْ مِنْ مُوَحِدْ يَخَافُ اللَّهُ فِينَا. Is there any monotheist that will help us for the sake of Allah? Any muwahid, anyone who says La ilaha illallah, any one of you, will you come to our aid now? This was the desperation of Hussein Mu'mineen. This is why we say As-salamu ala gharib al-ghuraba. This is why we say peace be upon the estranged and lonely of the lonely. But the women's screams would continue. Kulthum now turns to Zain al-Abidin. Zain al-Abidin comes out of the tent, limping to go into battle. Kulthum turns to Zain al-Abidin, salamullahi alayhi, to come back to the tent, and he turns to his aunt and he says, oh my aunt, how can I not go when my family has been killed in front of me? Imam Zain al-Abidin is injured. Imam Zain al-Abidin is limping. He cannot barely walk. And he's trying now to go to fight because everyone is gone. Khalas, everyone is gone. Imam turns to Kulthum and says, take him and please put him back in the tent, for he is the Imam after me. Hussein is now wearing a dark jubbah. And his amama had two ends tied to it. Hussein is now wrapped in used garments and used clothes. And all he could hear is al-atash, al-atash, al-atash. Ya Aba Abdullah. Thirst, thirst, thirst. Imagine, and he's wearing used clothes. Old clothes. Which brings me back to a conversation he had with Qasim. Right, in that night where he asked Qasim, what do you think of death, right? Qasim tells Hussein that death is sweeter to me than honey. We know this, but then what does Hussein say? He says, may your uncle be sacrificed for you, O Qasim. But the greatest bala will be for my son Abdullah, the suckling baby infant. Why? Because the baby Abdullah Ali al-Asghar had no milk. So Imam turns to Kulthum after the death of Ali Akbar and he asks about his baby. Because his baby had no milk for so many days. In another riwayat, Tabarsi narrates in Ihtijaj that Imam turns to Rubab, the mother of the baby, Abdullah Radi, the suckling, nursing baby. He says, hand me the baby. Rubab says, why? Ya Abdullah, you're busy in the battle, my husband. Don't worry about the baby is with me. Yeah, husband. She's trying to give sukoon to her husband on the day of Ashura. Do you know what Hussein tells Rubab, the Tabrizi narrates in Ihtijaj? He says, Hatta uwaddi'uhu, so that I may give farewell to this baby. So that I may do wida' for the baby. So he sat him into his lap. Ajlasahu fi hijri, in his hijr, his lap. Shall I narrate now what Hussein did to the baby? وَيُقَبِّلُهُ, and he began kissing the infant in his lap. So just, I want you to close your eyes, Mu'mineen, tonight. This is the night of the 10th of Muharram. Hussein is kissing his little infant baby in his lap. He says, wail only ha'ulai al-qawm, may these people be cursed. For their enemy will be Rasulullah on the day of judgment. He then turns to the army of Umar ibn Sa'd. He says, in lam tarhamuni, if you will have no mercy and rahmah for me, farhamu hadhal tifl, have mercy on this baby. Meaning, for what sin has this baby done? Laythan min khutilat, as the ayat of Quran tells us about the child. For what then, what sin has this baby done? He is begging for his baby. He is pleading with the army of Umar ibn Sa'd. He says, basically, you have killed everyone. Everyone is gone, mu'mineen. Think of the thirst of Hussein, the ghurbat of Hussein. He was sitting in the lap of Hussein ibn Ali. But mu'mineen, ya sahib al-zaman, my heart breaks to relate what happens next. Imam is kissing his baby. Faramau harmala bi sahmin. Harmala fires an arrow. The baby in the lap of Abu Abdullah. Min udhun al udhun, from ear to ear. Abu Abdullah is covered in the blood of his baby. Imam al-Zaman says, al-muttashahid dama, that the baby choked on his own blood. This is the worst kind of maut. Ear to ear, min udhun ila udhun. Wa Husayna, Imam then dug a grave. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi.
بقضائي والتسليما لأمره. Imam dug a little grave for his baby, but the blood bubbled into the sand. How could he go back to Rubab? Even the qabr was covered in blood. The Imam has blood in his hands and he throws it towards the heavens. Imam Bakr says, not a drop of the blood landed on the earth. لساخت الأرض على أهلها, because the earth would swallow its people. السلام على ابن فاطمة الزهراء وإمام وحسين وغرغريبا وعطشانا. ماتم حسين
حسين الغريب غريبا حسين شهيدا شهيدا حسين الغريب غريب حسين حسين شهيدا شهيدا حسين سلام on the head of my Mawla Hussain Salams on the lips of my blessed Hussain For days in the desert your body remained without Shroud they became your body trampled. No one left to help you. Your body trampled, left in pieces. Your body. The grief and the mourning for you, oh Hussein, Hussein al-Gharib al-Gharib al-Hussein, Hussein al-Shahid al-Shahid al-Salam. Salams on your parched tongue, oh my son. Your screams and cries piercing through the air. The strength of the three-pronged slicing the air. I threw your blood, but none took heed. The sky turned dark, the earth did bleed. Your tiny hands in silence plead. A martyr's tale in sorrow's street, Hussein al-Gharib, al-Gharib, al-Hussein, Hussein al-Shahid, al-Shahid, the screams of the children thirsty for water, the duty was sent to Abbas, our Savior, the Lion of God could be seen. But how does he fall from the horse with no hands? The flag of Islam laid bare on the sands. Hussein al-Gharib, al-Gharib, al-Hussein, Hussein al-Shahid, Shahid al. A lady was seen peering out from the tents. A cry from the heavens that Zahra presents. Oh, Shimmer, oh, Shimmer, why on his chest the sword stained in blood was Hussein's final test. Hussein, to your mother, it's time to ascend. Your trials in Karbala have come to an end. Hussein al-Gharib, al-Gharib, al-Hussein.
Hussein, Hussein,
Hussein,
Hussein,
Hussein,
Hussein, Hussein, Hussein, Hussein, Hussein, Hussein, Hussein, Hussein, Hussein, Hussein, Hussein, Hussein, Hussein, Hussein, Hussein, Hussein, Hussein, Hussein, Hussein, Hussein, Hussein, Hussein, Hussein, Hussein, تیرے بغیر ماں. چہرہ وہ چاند جیسا, چہرہ وہ چاند جیسا, کیسے بھلائے ماں. اصغر جیے گی کیسے تیرے بغیر ماں. اے میرے بے زبان, تم رہ گئے کہاں, اصغر جیے گی کیسے تیرے بغیر ماں. اے میرے بے زبان, تم رہ گئے کہاں, اصغر جیے گی کیسے تیرے بغیر ماں. اے میرے بے زبان. اصغر جیے گی کیسے تیرے بغیر ماں. کیا وقت آ گیا ہے بانوں کی بے کسی پر غربت پہ تیری ماتم کیسے کرے گی مادر. آدانے باندھ دی ہیں آدانے باندھ دی ہیں ہاتھوں میں رسیاں اصغر جیے گی کیسے تیرے بغیر ماں. اے میرے بے زبان تم رہ گئے اصغر جیے گی کیسے تیرے بغیر ماں. اے میرے بے زبان تم رہ گئے کہاں اصغر جیے گی کیسے تیرے بغیر ماں. ہمت پہ ماں تمہاری کیوں نہ جائے سنتی ہوں تیر کھا کر تم رن میں مسکرائے. مادر کی لاج رکھ لی مادر کی لاج رکھ لی شاباش میری جان اصغر جیے گی کیسے تیرے بغیر ماں. اے میرے بے زبان تم رہ گئے کہاں اصغر جیے گی کیسے تیرے بغیر ماں. اے میرے بے زبان تم رہ گئے کہاں اصغر جیے گی کیسے تیرے بغیر ماں.
شہادہ
He is my Abba, the son of Zahra.
He is Allah's inqida.
Umar Bab, Umar Bab, oh, our lady.
the throne.
You hear this angel weeping alone. Her cries of Abba challenge the throne.
She is Sakina, my little princess.
She is Sakina, my little princess.
Her Sahara is
Bhutura. Oh, not a single moment of calm from the streets of Kufa to Sham.
Oh, can you see us, oh, our Shia?
Oh, can you see us, oh, our Shia?
At the mercy of
every mob.
In Salah,
you smell the fragrance of Mustafa in the tears of his shed in Salah.
With every manzil, with every moment,
with every manzil, with every moment,
he is aging in his
Shabbat. For your noble resistance, Hussein, I would offer my two kids again.
But for your trampled, unshrouded body,
say, but for your trampled, unshrouded body,
I will stand under the sun and
sob.
Salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Please kindly get ready for Salat.